My guest tonight has been, I hate to use the word broadcasting, broadcasting legend in the Delaware Valley for over 50 years, and now he's written a book about it. The title of the book is You Only Rock Once. The author is my pal, Jerry Blavitt. DeGeeter.
David.
Good to see you.
It's good to see you. I remember the last time we were together. How many years ago was that?
For television, it was 11 years, but we hung out right before you celebrated a milestone birthday.
Yes, yes,
Last July. Not this past July, but the July before that.
This July is going to be another year.
It's another year. Exactly. All right. So I already said that you celebrated a milestone birthday in July of 10.
Turned 71.
Now you're 71.
71.
And 51 years in front of the microphone. Yeah. And now you've written the book, You Only Rock Once. Why now?
Well, because, you know, I think radio is not the same. TV is not the same as it was. And I realize that. And I think there are many young people who want to go back to a better time in show business. The show business that I grew up in and the show business that you know is not the same. I mean, I was fortunate at a very early age, which you will read in the book at 13, to see a show called Bandstand. Before that, I came from a broken family, which is in the book. My father was Jewish, my mother was Italian. They married out of their faith. She was disowned.
Back then, that was just not done.
You didn't do that stuff. So she was disowned. And my father, who was a bookmaker, a Jewish racketeer back then, was never around. So my mother had to go to work the Navy Yard. So for her to go to work the Navy Yard, she would take me and my sister to St. Monica's Day Nursery every morning. While the kids were outside playing summertime, I'm in bed because we got to get up to go to the nursery school. And I discovered radio. I would listen to the Lone Ranger, Straight Arrow, and I became a radio kid, listening to radio because I was a lonely kid.
But you're listening more to serials than music?
But back then.
Okay, right.
So then what happens? My uncles are appearing on Bandstand, Bob Horn's Bandstand, not Dick Clark. And I, at the early age of 13, discover music and dancing. And that's how my life began. And fulfilling the loneliness that I had was music. Making me happy was dancing. And in the book, you will read that I went on Bandstand, became the dancer, won 2 dance contests. And because of that, Bob Horn said, you can't get into the contest any longer. You now will be the head of the dance committee. You will rotate the dancers. And I met Tony Bennett and Frank Sinatra and Sammy Davis Jr. And it's a great story about Sammy. I was jitterbugging and Sammy was a guest on Bandstand. And if the folks out there remember, Bob Horn would say, we have company, and then the camera would go right on to the artist. So one of my duties was to make sure that the artist was on the spot when he said, we have company. But this guy's watching me dance. And before I take him to the spot, he says to me, I got to ask you a question. Where'd you learn how to dance like that? I said, man, everybody in South Philly dances like that. I said, we do it to impress the girls. He said, man, you look like a little white me. I said, no. It was Sammy, and we became lifelong friends. And because of that, when Bob lost the show, I opted to stay with Bob Horn, and I led the picket lines. And I got arrested. And there's a great story. As a matter of fact,
this is when he lost the show to Dick. To Dick Clark.
Dick Clark took over.
Right.
But we didn't know who Dick Clark was, so I led a protest.
Well, nobody really knew who Dick was at the time.
I mean, Dick Clark at that time was doing Bars Diamond Theater commercials on Channel 6. And I lead a protest, and Dick Clark comes out with George Kohler, the head of WFIL, with Roger Clip, and they take me into the office. They say, look, Bob's not coming back. You're the head of the committee. Let the kids in, we will double your salary. I was getting paid $15 a week. I said, nope, we want Bob Horn. I go out, I start the picket, the cops come, they arrest me. Down comes the pickets.
And you were how old?
16.
16, okay.
That's the end of my career on Bandstand. But what happened is when Dick took over Bandstand, everything that Bob had, the publishing companies, the record things, and in those days, David, there was no law against a disc jockey owning pieces of records or publishing back then. So everything that Bob had reverted to Dick Clark. And Dick Clark has a record called At the Hop. He's got the publishing on that. Well, Nat Sigel, who was Bob Horn's partner, remains close with Dick Clark. He becomes the manager of Danny and the Juniors. I'm not on Bandstand, so I'm hanging out with Nat Sigel. Nat Sigel also is booking the Celebrity Room in Philadelphia. And one of the artists that he's booked is a guy by the name of Don Rickles, who in 1957 is an unknown.
He was an actor.
He was an actor, Run Silent, Run Deep.
Right.
The first, and there's a great story in the book, how I met Sinatra, because of the movie. They had the world premiere of Run Silent, Run Deep in Atlantic City at the Globe. Sinatra's movie, Hole in the Head, was also playing, and Frank was at the 500. So I went with Rickles to see his movie. We then went over to the 500 Club, and Skinny was there, and Skinny knew me, and Rickles says, Mr. S, this is Jerry Blavip. I wasn't the Geeter, and he shakes my hand, and that was it. So Rickles then says to me, that was Frank Sinatra, Fisher. But you're not impressed? So it would be Chuck Berry, I certainly would be impressed.
So even back then, you were drawn toward that music.
And
before anybody thinks that you know, because you led an insurrection against Dick, and Dick's going to take out a contract on you now at this advanced age, we might note that the foreword to You Only Rock Once was written by Dick Clark. So.
Well, it's a great story how that happened. He's got Danny the Juniors. I became the road manager. He's doing a Saturday night show called the Beach Nut Gum Saturday Night Show. We go to do the show in New York. He sees me. It's the first time I've seen him since I picketed him. And he's very cordial. Jerry, how are you? Fine, Dick. Very good. I stay over in New York City. I'm going back the following day, Pennsylvania Station. Who's getting on the train? Dick Clark, same train. He says, Jerry, Sid, I want to talk to you. I figure, oh, wow.
How'd you figure that conversation was going to go?
I figure, oh, okay. So he says, you know, see these kids on Bandstand? They're national stars. He said, you were the best dancer. You would have been a national star. They get fan mail, Teen Magazine. He said, you tried to picket me. We offered you $30 a week instead of $15. He says, no, let me finish. He says, even though you tried to do that, I have great respect for you, because I know if I lose Bandstand tomorrow, all these people who are kissing my butt will go to the next guy who comes in. I know I will not have the loyalty that you had shown to Bob. We got off that train and I said, Dick Clark, you have my loyalty. This is 1957.
Wow.
And we've been friends since. And when I went on radio in 60, and all the other disc jockeys were knocking the heck out of me because they said I was an upstart. What's he know about radio? Dick Clark would go on TV and said, hey, you remember Jerry Blavity used to dance locally? He's got a great radio show. I go home at night and I'm listening to him on the radio. So he did more good for me. And I got to tell you something, David, as you know, many people do not give Dick Clark the proper credit. If it wasn't for Dick Clark, many of these stars who have a resurgence today would not have a career. Before Dick Clark came along, the major record companies would cover all of the little artists. I'll give you an example. When I was on Bandstand, one of my duties was to select the records for Bob Horn, Rate the Record. So he would give me five records. Pat Boone, Ain't It a Shame, Perry Como, Kokomo, the Fontaine Sisters, Hearts of Stone, and I would say, yo, Bob, why don't you get the original record? He said, the original record? He said, these are the national labels. I said, no. Get the original records. Dick Clark, when he went on Bandstand, would play the original version of a song. If it's seen coast to coast, no one had a chance. The majors could not cover it. So all of these wonderful little independent labels, all of these wonderful artists, Frankie, Dion, all of these people became major stars.
Right. So let's say you're 19, going on 20 years old.
Yeah.
Okay, you're already a retired, washed-up dancer from Bandstand. You've been a road manager for Danny and the Juniors.
A valet for Don Rickles,
a friend of Sammy Davis Jr.,
right.
A good friend of Sammy's. How do you get to the microphone? How do you make that? I mean, that's a big leap.
It's a great story. I was married at 19. And I married a girl who was much older than me, Patty, who had a child. My mother disapproved of that. I don't want you to marry this girl, la-di-da-da-da. So, mom in love. So for a period of time, my mom did not acknowledge the marriage. And I was crushed on that. I got off the road, and I hadn't seen my mom for maybe 6 months. And I decided I'm going to go back to where I was born, 1906 at Bancroft. And I knocked at the door. My mom opened up the door. And I saw in her eyes that she, too, missed me. And she said, come on in, let's have a cup of coffee. And I knew that we were together again. I felt good. Mm. I go out. I say, let me go back to the corner where I used to hang at, 17th and Mifflin. Okay? I go back to the corner. Pat says, the guys are shooting crap around the corner. So I get into a crap game. I feel lucky. I say, this is my great day. I'm happy my mothers were bonded. I feel lucky. Guys are shooting crap. One of the guys owns a club, and he's doing street talk. I need somebody to do a radio show. So one of the wise guys say, yeah, well, Jerry Blabber, he knows everything about show business, sarcastically, okay? So I said, yeah, I can do a show. What do you know about it? I said, I got a six. If I make my number, you let me do a radio show. You'll never make the number, they're yelling. I go, bop, boom, bop, bop. Third, I make the six. He says, okay, go do a radio show.
Wait, you mean to tell me that your career
was on a crap game?
On a one roll of the dice?
Exactly how I got.
What if you rolled a five?
I would probably be
me
driving a cab, or probably doing a bus, or maybe I would have been an Orbitine priest.
Oh, that's funny.
So he says, do a show. I go, I make a deal on WCAM in Camden. You could buy any type of hour, right? The Polish hour, the Spanish hour, the Italian hour, the gospel. Now I got the Jerry Blabber hour. I'm doing it from the Venus Lounge. And in the book, you'll see I had Annette Funicello on. I'm doing talk like you do talk radio, right? Okay? Snowstorm closes it down. I own the time, can't get to the club, so I take all my old rock and roll records, Little Richard, Fats Domino, Jerry Lee Lewis, and I go into the snowstorm up to the station. I'm doing dances in South Philly on the side. Kids help me out, shovel out. They come to the studio, and I'm starting to play all this. The kids now are surfing the dial to see if they're out of school. All of a sudden, they're hearing Chuck Berry, Fats Domino, Little Richard, music from 1956, 57, and 58. To them, it's brand new. It was exciting. They never heard anything, and they hear this guy, I'm making things up, rhyming. I don't get home. I stay there 4 hours. The next morning, the station manager calls up, said, what'd you do last night? And I said, I'm only supposed to be on an hour. I said, well, he said, no. He said, I know. He said, what were you playing? I said, my records that I danced to on Bandstand. He said, whatever you did, we've never had a reaction like that. That was the end of my career as a talk host and the beginning of the Geeter with the Heater, the boss with the hot sauce, my man, Pots and Pans.
Would it be fair to say, though, musically, right, you kind of stopped around the late 60s with American artists? I mean, I listen to you now on Cool 98.3, Monday through Friday, but your music is, from what I hear, to my ear, mostly American artists.
Oh yeah,
99% American artists.
I didn't play. I never played English.
I know. One thing you will never hear is Jerry saying, "Now this is number one song from
Dave
the Beatles."
Dave Clark Five.
Here's the Dave Clark
Here's
Five.
Here's Herman's Hermits.
Exactly.
Here's Freddie and the Freeloaders.
No, but did you have something against them?
No. Okay. To me, that music was bubblegum. As great as the Beatles became, at the very beginning it was, she loves you, yeah, 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 I want to hold your hand. That wasn't, good golly, Miss Molly,
no wonder
ain't that
like
a
them.
Shame. I mean, you see, I'm doing interviews on the book. And David, everybody says to me, what's wrong with the youth of America today? It's the music that they're listening to. The music, the message in the music today is not good. Our music back then, and the music that you hear on Cool 98.3, is good music. It makes you feel good. It's music with a lyric that you can relate to. That English sound was very, very square to me. Very, very square to me. But I'll tell you what I did do, which you're going to read in the book. The audience listened to me because it was brand new to them, my oldies.
Right.
And then I incorporated the Four Seasons, the Chiffons, the Isley Brothers, because I had the ability then. And people say, what's the success of Blabber? The freedom for me to play music from a heart, not a research chart.
And the fact that you, wherever you've been, you bought your airtime.
Absolutely.
You've never worked for anybody except for Jerry Blevins.
Listen, the secret of life is you believe in something, and that's why I wrote the book for young people. Young people, when they read it, they come up to me and say, wow, what a career you had. Because I had the freedom to follow my passion. The guy upstairs, I've been blessed. As a lonely kid, it was radio, it was music that fulfilled me. My greatest joy is when I see people smile. I mean, I get people who come to see me at Memories in the clubs. I swear to you, anywhere between the ages of 16, there's a lady, I call her Betty Davis. She's 89 years old. 89 years old. She dances, she smiles. So if I can take people away, as Kool does, for a brief period of time, and bring back better memories of yesteryear, what's the reward?
I was looking through some of the comments that you have elicited from a lot of artists at the beginning of the book, and the one that stood out, and the one that stood out wasn't Rickles. I mean, Rickles was funny, but the one I love the best is the Geeter is the last disc jockey, and that's from little Stephen Van Sant
from
Bruce Springsteen's E Street Band. Do you feel that way? Are you the last DJ?
I hope not.
Out of respect to the others.
I'll tell you something about Kool 98.3. Dave Kosky and his team, Paul Kelly and those guys, and you know these guys, know the value of the importance of radio personalities. Mm-hmm. And he has gathered around personalities. Am I the last disc jockey? I hope not. Is Kool doing the right thing? Yeah. But they're the only ones doing it. You know, when I was a kid, when you went out on a date, after the date you picked up the phone, you called the disc jockey.
Right.
Hey, play this song for this girl. And the Geeter would say, hey, this is for this girl. And the guy would say, hey, play this song for that girl. It was a communication. You guys in talk radio and talk what you're doing right now are the last of the personalities. Because your audience identifies with the guest, the host, and the subject that we're talking about.
Live and local.
Absolutely.
Live and local.
That's what it was all about. Radio back in the day, you know it, was owned by local ownership.
Right.
So they knew the importance of the community with giving them programs, sports shows, talk shows, news that applied to the community.
And in some cases, music that was done locally.
Absolutely.
I mean, a lot of radio stations started out local artists.
You know, I do a show on WXPN on Saturdays, University of Pennsylvania. They do that. They feature local artists, and that's the important thing of what we do.
Wow. The name of the book is You Only Rock Once, and the author is the great Jerry Blevins. Jerry,
David,
good to see you.
It is always a pleasure.
Continued success.
Thank you.
I can't wait to get into this book.
Okay.